I want to read for you from the book of Matthew, the 25th chapter. This is another one of Jesus' famous parables. This one is the parable of the three servants. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like this. Once there was a man who was about to leave home on a trip. He called his servants and put them in charge of his property. He gave to each one according to his ability. To one he gave 5,000 gold coins. To another he gave 2,000. And to another he gave 1,000. Then he left on his trip. The servant who had received 5,000 coins went at once and invested his money and earned another 5,000. In the same way, the servant who had received 2,000 coins earned another 2,000. But the servant who had received 1,000 coins went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants came back and settled accounts with them. The servant who had received 5,000 coins came in and handed over the other 5,000. "You gave me 5,000 coins, sir," he said. "Look, here are another 5,000 that I have earned." "Well done, you good and faithful servant," said his master. "You have been faithful in managing small accounts, so I will put you in charge of large amounts. Come on in. Share my happiness." Then the servant who had been given 2,000 coins came in and said, "You gave me 2,000 coins, sir. Look, here are another 2,000 that I have earned." "Well done, you good and faithful servant," said his master. "You have been faithful in managing small amounts, so I will put you in charge of large amounts. Come on in and share my happiness." Then the servant who had received 1,000 coins came in and said, "Sir, I know you are a hard man. You reap harvests where you did not plant, and you gather crops where you did not scatter seed. I was afraid, so I went off and hid your money in the ground. Look, here is what belongs to you." "You bad and lazy servant," his master said. "You knew, did you, that I reap harvests where I did not plant and gather crops where I did not scatter seed? Well then, you should have deposited my money in the bank, and I would have received it all back with interest when I returned. Now, take the money away from him and give it to the one who has 10,000 coins. For to every person who has something, even more will be given, and he will have more than enough. But the person who has nothing, even the little that he has, will be taken away from him. As for this useless servant, throw him outside in the darkness. There he will cry and gnash his teeth." The parable of the three servants. Part of me thinks I should talk to an investment broker in order to understand it. Maybe I should be asking the broker what I would have to do and what risks I would have to take in order to double my money. In all probability, the broker will tell me about the rule of 72. Which, of course, I'd never heard of before last week. The rule of 72 goes like this. If your investment has a guaranteed rate or guaranteed interest rate of 5%, you divide that rate into 72, and the answer will be the number of years it will take to double your money. So, if my math is correct, 5 into 72 equals roughly 14 and a half years. At an interest rate of 5%, it will take almost 14 and a half years to double your money. Glenn's shaking his head, so I think my math is right. Thank you, Glenn. Of course, if you want to double your money more quickly, you'll have to take more risk, right? We know that. In the world of venture capital, for example, only 1 out of 4 or 5, some say 1 out of 10, makes it. The others lose everything. Nothing ventured, nothing gained. Now, Jesus tells his parable of the 3 servants in the middle of his own high-risk venture. We're fortunate enough, in a sense, to know the end of the story, so we can recognize that this is true. He tells this story during the last few days of his life, after he's already left the safety of the Galilee, risking everything to go to Jerusalem. There, as we know, the religious authorities will see him as a threat to the status quo and their own power. And the Romans will see him as a troublemaker and a disturber of the Pax Romana, the peace. The parable Jesus tells is about a wealthy man who goes away on a long journey. And before he leaves, as you probably recall, he gives each of his 3 servants a certain amount of money. And the first servant takes his money to the market, to an investment broker, you might say, and invests in high-risk ventures. He's willing to take high risk. And the second servant does the same thing. He puts his money to work at high risk. And both servants do extremely well. Both reap high rewards beyond even the rule of 72. When their master returns, he's very pleased. Well done, the master says, and promises them more responsibility in the future. Right? So that's how the parable goes. But the third servant does something quite different with his 1,000 coins. He buries them in the ground for safekeeping. Now, in times of economic growth and a bullish market, maybe a bullish stock market like we see today, you might think that the third servant was foolish for doing this, right? But in times of stock market decline, wouldn't you think rather he was very wise? He's not a bad man, this third servant. To the contrary, he's prudent, he's careful, he's a cautious investor. He's about to take chances with his master's money. And every penny of it is there when his master returns. And the servant is proud of himself. He's actually proud. And he should be. Here it is, he says to his master. All of it safe and sound. And yet, for his efforts, he's treated as harshly as anyone in the whole Bible. So, does that leave you scratching your heads? I can't help but wonder how it would have turned out if the first 2 servants had put the master's money into high-risk venture capital projects and lost it all. Had they, say, invested with Lehman Brothers just before the Wall Street crash in 08? Right? What would have been the outcome then? Now, Jesus, of course, did not tell the story that way. But I imagine that the story's master would not have praised the two servants, right, had that been the case. In that situation, the master would have only praised the third servant for burying his coins and not losing them. Am I correct, Glenn? Okay. Make sure I'm on track here. But of course, the point of the parable is not about doubling your money and accumulating more wealth, right? It's not about that at all. Rather, the point of the parable is about living. It's about living. It's about investing wildly. Right? It's about investing wildly in all those things that give us life. It's about taking risks on behalf of others. It's about Jesus himself and what he has done and what's about to happen to him. He took the risk. He rolled the dice. He was willing to. And we know the end of that story. Mostly, the parable is about what Jesus hopes and expects of his disciples after he's gone. It's about being a follower of Jesus and what it means to be faithful to him. And so finally, the parable is about you and me. The point of the parable is about you and me living out our Christian calling. It's about you and me finding the beauty and the joy that exists all around God's good creation. It's about you and me discovering what it means to live life abundantly. What does that mean? And then helping others to make that same discovery too. That's what the parable's all about. And when we are with others who have lost their spark, who can no longer imagine what living life abundantly even looks like, it's about you and me trying as best we can, even risking failure, to help these people catch sight, just catch sight of the beauty and the joy in life that they've long been missing. And if sometimes, despite all our best efforts, despite all we've tried to do to improve their lives, these people refuse to see the beauty, choosing instead to remain stuck in the quicksand of their own personal hell, then sadly, it's about you and me knowing when it's time to walk away. Do you think something similar is going on with the third servant in our parable? Can it be that he just cannot see the goodness of his master, choosing instead to fear him? Think that might be going on? Has the third servant chosen suspicion and doubt instead of trust and love? Safety and security instead of courage and risk? Indifference instead of care and concern? Darkness instead of light? Meager life instead of abundant life? Hell instead of heaven? Could this be going on? Because you see, the greatest risk of all, I believe, the greatest risk of all is not to risk anything. Not to care deeply enough about anything. Right? Not to invest deeply in anything. Not to give your heart away to something. Something. And in the process, you risk everything. The greatest risk of all, in my view, is to play it safe. To live over-cautiously and over-prudently. Greatest risk of all is to live not caring, not loving, not rejoicing, not living up to the full potential of our humanity, playing it safe, investing nothing of ourselves. Being overly cautious and prudent, digging a hole and burying God's treasure in the ground. And Jesus warns that the outcome of living this way is akin to death, like being banished to the outer darkness. Why do you need to know this? Why is this parable important? How does it relate to your life? Well, Jesus invites us to be his disciples. That's why we don the label Christian. And he wants us to live our lives as fully as possible by investing in the lives of others, by risking, by taking more responsibility for others. To be his man or woman, he says, is not so much believing ideas about him as it is following him. Right? Following his way, with a capital W, his way of living. It is to be bold, it is to be brave, to reach high, and to care deeply. And the parable is an invitation to an adventure of risk. An adventure of risky faith, if that makes sense. The high-risk venture of being a true disciple of Christ. And through this parable, now that we've heard it, we are asked to respond. And one way or another, we will, by the way we act, and by the way we love, and by the way we care. So choose well, my friends. Choose well. Soli Deo Gloria. Amen.